Some difference, don't you think? Welcome to Dodger Town, the 23rd edition of the Best in Adult Baseball Camp. On the first night of camp, a poolside party gives all those free agents a chance to relax and meet the camp instructors. Have fun tonight, guys. Tomorrow we'll find out what kind of shape you're in.
Welcome to Dodger Town to our 28 rookies.
Before we get started for real, Dodger Town director Craig Callen and camp supervisor Guy Wellman complete the coaches' introductions and generally let the campers know what's in store for them this week.
Albuquerque Club first, and the manager will be in this afternoon, Carl Erskine. But on his staff, he will have Don Zimmer of the Colorado Rockies and Dave Wallace, our new Dodger pitching coach. At San Antonio, the manager is Clem Labine. Reggie Smith is his hitting coach. And Leo Posada. For Vero Beach, Bill Russell. Preacher Rowe is his pitching coach. And John Devis. Great Falls. And we welcome a new man, Jeff Torberg. Ralph Branca, and Dennis Llewellyn. And this is a new club. We just made it up here. San Bernardino. Rick Mundy is the manager. Ron Paranoski. And John Shoemaker. In the batting cages at all times, the great Duke Snyder. You're going down now to a Hall of Fame trainer, and he will put you through the stretching. Now, some of the stuff, if it gets too much for you, you can always back off. But the stretching is the same stretching that we give to the big leaguers and to the minor leaguers here in camp, and it keeps you loose. I'll tell you that. It'll help you.
The first order of business for the Dodger training staff to show the campers how to stretch out all those muscles they may not have used for a while. Hey, this is spring training, and stretching and running is a big part of it. Looks like fun to me.
The shovel and dirt, and not even worry about getting hurt. Ain't that tough enough? Ain't that tough enough? Ain't that tough enough? Ain't that tough enough?
Ain't
hours, 7 days a week, just so I can come home and kiss your cheek. I love you in the morning, and I love you at noon. I love you in the night, and take you to the moon. Ain't that tough enough?
Hi there, I'm Jim Lee, better known as King Kong Bundy, and this sure is a lot of fun, but right now, I'd like you to meet a few of my friends.
I'd like to thank my mom and everybody else who had anything to do with this, all her customers, and for giving me the opportunity to come down here and work out with the Dodgers. And fantasy camp is great.
Hi guys, I want to thank Gus and Pat and Dick and Mike for getting me in shape to be able to come here. Without you guys, I wouldn't be doing half as well as what I'm doing. So thanks a lot and having a lot of fun.
Hi guys, just want to say hi and thank you Zell and Mark and Annette, Tracy for encouraging me to come down here, having a good time, and it's been all worth it. Thanks a lot.
Okay, I want to say hi to all the kids and family back in West Virginia, and thanks to Cheryl for having me down here this week.
Okay, I'd like to thank Donna for encouraging me to come down here. Thanks, babe. And hopefully someday Joseph will make enough money to afford to send me back. Thank you.
Hi, this is Jennifer, and I just want to say thanks so much to Barry and Monique of the LA Dodgers for this wonderful opportunity to be here. Thanks, guys.
I want to thank my wife, Cheryl, for talking me into coming to this camp. It's been the greatest experience of my life. And I also want to say hello to my grandchildren, Tyler, Jennifer, and Kimberlyn. See you soon.
Welcome to Dodgertown, the land of baseball fantasy. Marianne, David, and Michael, this is your 50-year-old dad enjoying the second coming of my baseball career. See you later.
Hi, Don Robbins from Los Angeles, California. I just have to say this is truly a fantasy land. They call it Dodger Town, but it's fantasy town. It's unbelievably great. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bruce Sobel, must be November 10th, 1994. My fantasy has come alive. And Danielle, Gabriel, and Nathan, I just hope someday that you guys will be able to get here. It's great. Bye.
Doug Jacobson from Huntington Beach, California. They now call him Dodger Boy. Reggie Smith's coming to him for hitting advice. Duke from fielding advice. Erskine for pitching. I'm just proud to help all the young guys anything I can. Dean and the kids, thanks for making this all possible. Dodger Boy Blue. Thank you.
Now, there's nothing easier to catch than a lazy fly ball, except a moment ago.
Instruction to Dodgertown is the best you can find anywhere, and will go on every day this week. It all comes down to hitting, pitching, and fielding by the campers, and for the managers, it all comes down to picking the right team out of a hat and keen managing strategy, and maybe a little luck.
And move that ball with a little authority, and move it, you get a chance to get on base. And that's what you're down here for, to get on base and have some fun, learn your fundamentals of the game. But if you get those lazy fly balls, everybody wants them. And they're usually caught. Occasionally or not, a couple of drops yesterday, but that's going to happen. That happened in the Candlestick Park with us quite often. That wind used to blow up there, something terrible, until they filled it in a little bit. I remember one game, I was with the Mets, Roger Craig was pitching for the Mets, and a high fly ball went up, and I was playing left field. A high fly ball went up to left field, and I started take a step back because it looked like it was hit pretty good. And by the time I took a step back, I said, uh-oh, the wind started taking the ball
and I'm running as hard as I can in towards shortstop to catch the ball. Larry Burrider, who was our shortstop that particular time, is running out. And pretty soon, I pass him coming in, he passes me going out. And the ball landed right where Burrider left the shortstop. And it looked like the ball was going to be going against the fence when it was first hit. That's how bad the wind was.
In this fashion, where the left foot is closer to home plate and the right foot is pulled back, and those are even exaggerated to the point where they're really close, where the pitcher will actually see a player's number. And as I start to do that, you can start to see my right eye disappear a little bit. And to me, these are the least, this is the least favorite of my of the styles of approaches or stances of the play, I should say, because you start to lose a significant percentage of vision out of your back eye. So you start to say up to 40%, and it's tough enough to hit a baseball coming at you 90 miles an hour with both eyes and trying to look out of less than 1.5. So if you do use this style, the one thing that you have to be careful of is to make sure that you do get your head around as far as possible to give you the best possible look at the ball.
Of course, the stance on the mound with the spikes, these aren't spikes, we have them here and there. And what you want to do is just get it in the middle for now. We start moving people over on different type of pitchers they are, whatever we want to do with that. But for now, just stand in the middle, but have a good firm footing by this foot, and not on top of the rubber. Because obviously when you make your pivot, you're gonna slip and slide, or it's gonna get stuck, and you're not gonna have the leverage, and of course not the control, and you might hurt your arm by slipping off the rubber. So have your feet just kind of parallel with your shoulders, and a good body bounce here. Okay? And then a lot of times, you know, the old pitchers are still always winding up and everything, whatever. Some of that is great, the type of pitcher you are. Like Don, Big Don is very deceptive with that. Because he threw that swing and he had those big long arms and it came from the side. He was a tough pitcher against right-handers, especially against everybody. But that he utilized everything he had. But basically, I just like to have it just, you know, what I want to do is get less movement as possible out of you so he won't throw you off. By doing that, have the ball in the glove already. I don't like to expose both like a hitter or to the coaches, but they can start relaying signs later on. But that's something that we look at later on. Good body balance. And I like to see someone just come back, so you get a rocking motion back here to where you're going to get your rocking and moving. You see a lot of pitchers come from here, here, and then go that way. Well, that's an individual. And that, obviously, there's going to be exceptions to the rules. But if you do just basic fundamentals like this, I think it's going to be a lot easier for you in the beginning. What I do is keep my eye on the target.
To pitch, you got to push to pitch. Any of you play golf? You know what hitting from the top means? Well, you can do the same mistake in pitching. You can be right up here, and you don't get anything good going on below the waist except to keep your balance. But pitch, do the stride right and everything, you need to push toward the target that you're doing. Same thing if you hit the ball at shortstop. Set this foot, and push.
They were talking and actually never did talk.
What was your last year? And then you left the people with
I moved out of Florida when I was 7 years old. Yeah.
Hey, we
I just read Duke's book. Oisk. And I was a time I was old enough to know anything about baseball. My father took me to Evans Field.
Nice memory.
You guys are great. You guys are great.
Right here. Look at this. Knocking the strings out. Right here. Boy.
Okay, so you go out there, you have that ball in your glove or in your hand, wherever you might want to hold it. Prefer the glove because you want to conceal it from the hitter as long as possible. You notice I'm standing on the rubber in what we call squared up. In other words, if I'm throwing to home plate, this is where I'm standing facing. I don't want to stand this way. Occasionally you may see a guy that does that, but you know, he's more the exception than the norm. But basically you're squared up a little bit looking at home plate, and the number one thing is balance. As you look, you have body balance. You know, if I'm right-handed, my weight's a little bit here on my right leg, okay, my pivot leg, okay? However you want to deliver the baseball, and everyone delivers it a little bit differently, that's up to you.
I'm throwing here. Watch my eye level and watch where I throw the ball. There, okay? But now, all of a sudden, my eyes are down in that catcher, right? My eyes are down in that catcher. I'm looking down at that catcher, and now look at where I'm at. I'm out there extending myself and following my sight, like having a gun. You shoot that way, bullet's gonna go that way.
But ours, where we work, if it was wrong, we would always get the blame, but it was right in time. You...
There you are. We had no problem with that.
But it puts the
actually, Joe. No, Joey did it all the time. He did it all the time. He's very good at it.
Now goes two and two, and you say to yourself, I know they're going. What a hell of a time to pitch out. But if you're wrong, now it becomes 3-2, and they open up the gates for everybody. And there's the manager mad at the coach. Well, do it yourself.
At about 15 minutes of infield play, we're going to have you take your position. Try to split up the positions if you can. A few first, second, short, third. Start off on the grass. We're going to hit you some easy ground balls. I want you to throw the ball back into me, just to get loosened up, and then we'll start backing up, and we'll go into some double plays, and it'll be about time to switch into the outfield, okay? A lot of fun over here. Just take it easy on your arm. You don't have to throw hard.
Right away, right here. Let's put a couple guys over at short. Try to even the lines out. Take one and rotate, one and out. Just switch.
Right leg has got to be straight at the pitcher. That one has got to be over straight. For example, I'm going to pitch. Yeah, okay, go ahead from there. Straight at the pitcher. The reason for that is you don't have a glove on that side to hide the signs. And the first base coach and the good base runner slides out there, and all he does is slide out there and look right in there, and he waits for a breaking ball and runs on it. Okay, so keep that one straight. Now this one should be somewhere around the knee, either on the outside of it or over the top. Now, the next thing that you really have to be aware of is where you give your signs. Make sure you give them in your crotch tight, right in here. Okay, you don't want to move them around here. You'll see some guys give them like this and all this.
Direction?
That's location, right. But you don't even have to do that much of that. Some guys will do it with their finger. I'm not coordinated enough to do that. And I also want to make sure that the pitcher and I knew what we were talking about, so I would do this. But don't be doing it by doing this.
So too much movement.
Well, from the dugout, I can see the arm moving. I don't see your fingers, but I know what you're doing. Okay? Now, let me see. You give the sign again. I can tell you whether... get down to that position again.
take. Now, the next position you want to take out of that is your ready stance to catch it. And all you do is slide your left foot forward. Okay, slide your left, that's the left, and just slide it up there a little bit. So, well, it depends. Different guys do it different ways. If you want to just spread it, they can go this way. But I would suggest you slide it up forward.
So more or less putting my weight.
Yeah, so now your weight's on this foot. Now the weight on this foot is on the full foot, and it basically you could almost catch like that.
Okay.
That this is kind of a guide for you. But what it allows you to do is catch, and then all of a sudden you can come up and throw, and you can feel a bunch, you can do everything. Okay? So try that again. Sign giving stance.
Hey, nice play.
Okay. Slide the left foot up, and now you're ready. Okay, now the next important thing. You guys did it very well, putting your hands in your glove. I don't teach one-handed catching, but I would here. There's no stealing, so there's no, don't worry about it. If you're working with kids, though, let me show you what I'd like to see. Okay, I've gone the sign-giving stance, I've slid forward, and I've given the target. Now, if you can see, I would like to describe maybe your target being given as though you're a dog begging for a bone, because what you've done is relax your wrist. Guys that extend their hands out and then put the full target, lock their wrist up. They end up dropping balls, catching balls this way, and can't get the glove turned around and balls in the dirt. If you have it back closer to your body, almost like a shock absorber, now you're a receiver. Now all of a sudden the ball's in the dirt, your hand just turns natural. Okay? I would normally teach bare hand next to the glove with runners on score and on the base in a position to run. But nowadays you see a lot of this. The only problem with this started with Johnny Bench. He put it back here, he was a great hitter, and he didn't want to take a chance. And he would catch the ball, stand up, and throw a rocket. Now, not everybody can do that. The problem being, when you go back here, the tendency is to reach farther and farther, and now you become a boxer rather than a receiver. Right. I would rather see you in it. But you can do the same thing if you're aware of what you're doing. Just relax it in here like this. And now you're a receiver. And then now you're not tired. Some guys do this, they get the tail up, and all of a sudden, boy, by the fourth inning, you're tired. You can't catch a high fastball. You're locked in here, and all of a sudden, the ball's up here, you can't get there. If you relax in here, look how you can do it. Well, and you're not exhausted when the game's over. And not only that, the pitcher has a good look at a guy who's squared up in an area that they feel like they can throw strikes down to.
Your left leg is bothering you?
Oh, on the hand.
Where's the bat right there?
Oh,
stepping a little bit too soon. There you go. That's better. A little better timing.
Good. Look at the bat surface that I have exposed. All of this now. So you'll start to hit balls better if you're thinking from center field to right field. And if you get there a little bit early, I still have a lot of bat surface exposed and I can go ahead and get that good ball to pull. Always going to be anywhere from 3 to 18 inches out front of home plate, depending where the guy stands at the plate. If he's further out here, obviously you can see that that's going to,
right,
to move. The guys will be making contact out here. And so what they've done, they've taken an average fastball, and they're trying to make contact here and making it a great fastball.
Right.
If they're in the, well, hit the ball a little bit deeper in the box, but I mean deeper in the zone. Guys think deep in the zone means here. If that ball gets over the plate on you, that's the ball you're going to foul in the dugout.
Right.
So that, you know, when you're starting and you're looking, you're talking about guy's back speed, look how often he's making contact out here.
I'm here.
Off the plate.
All right.
Yeah.
road for it.
We just gotta get you.
We say Duke.
Hold that up here. Leave that for control. A little late though. Get it up there, but you have to take it up there. Put the hazard and stuff up.
I wanna know what you're thinking.
There are some things you can't hide. I wanna know what you're feeling. Tell me what's on your mind.
Here's a few more of my Dodger Town buddies.
Wayne Canaster, South Orange, New Jersey. Jill, Dana, Devin, having a great time again. Made a deposit for next year. I hope you don't mind. And Gina, if you're watching this, Mike wouldn't stop talking about you all week.
Barry Scripps, San Diego, California. I just wanted to tell you, Gail, I never thought this would be my fourth year in a row, but it is. And I want to thank you for your patience for me being gone and being with the two kids and Brad McKenna. I'm looking forward to you coming back here someday, especially you, Brad. I'm going to play baseball. You'll be on this field someday. And looking forward to seeing you this Saturday.
Hi, I'm Harold Ganey from Forest Falls, California. I'd really like to thank Lori for letting me have this experience again. It's been terrific. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Alan Shackman, Livingston, New Jersey. I want to say hello to my wife, Renee, Pam, and David. I'm having a great camp. I'm having a great time. It'd be a lot better if my roommate wasn't such a rowdy. He's out all night. He comes in at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. He's drinking in the bar. He's playing cards. He's smoking, he's eating like a pig. But aside from that, I'm having a great time. The aches and pains are just about gone.
Hi, I'm Sandy Kriegler from Sherman Oaks, California. I want to thank my wife, Shelley, and my two sons, Brian and Greg, for letting me enjoy my sixth straight camp.
Hi, I'm Roger Hillman from Mercer Island, Washington. I'd like to thank my wife, Joanne, for sending me here. And Joe, your plan didn't work. I'm still alive.
Hi, I'm David Silvis from Short Hills, New Jersey, by way of Brooklyn. And I want to thank my dad for giving me the love of baseball, and glad my children, daughter Margot, or Gary, my son, continuing in the tradition of baseball. And thank my wife Susan for allowing me to have a great time. It's my rookie year. I put a deposit on for next year coming back. And thanks for Alan Shackman, my buddy, for encouraging me to come out and play like an 18-year-old again. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bob Hansen from Huntington Beach. Been coming down here since 1986. Having a great time. A little tough putting up with Alan Shackman and Ben Westland and Sandy Kriegler and those guys, but outside of that, we're having a great time. Not winning any ball games this year, but there's no pressure on us, so we're going to knock off the number one guys today. Anyway, we'll see you next year.
Hi, I'm Kurt Hansen from Huntington Beach, California. I'd like to say hi to my wife Brenda and Brianna and Nicholas. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Alan Forrest. I'm from Britnick, New York. I just want to thank my lovely bride for giving me this gift. I also want to say hello to my children, Josh and Lauren. This is absolutely a slice of heaven, and hopefully I can come back and do it another time. Thanks. Love you guys.
It's time to start the Grapefruit League games. Right now, everybody is tied for first place. But all that's about to change.
won't you help me, Dr. B?
Grass was very high today, but we did have a couple of high spots, including the double.
Every night, each team manager gives out the coveted potato head award to a player on his team. Today, it's an ugly old thing, but everybody wants to win one.
Okay, was almost a mistake.
No, I'm sorry. I knew that the Colonel Clink of Dodgertown would get it right. A single, an RBI double, Ben Westland. Our potato head award is for the big man. Jim Leahy hit, I think he was 4 for 5, at least 3 for 5.
Alan Forrest did such a great job defensively at first base. That would have been well enough alone. But he also got 4 hits, so he's our potato head award. He made a great play at third base. He moved to second base, pop fly over his head. He made another great play going into right field. And I felt that he was the guy to win the potato head award. And Bob, you're the man.
This is going to be one of my favorite pigeons of the week.
There's always something going on at Dodgertown. Whether it's hanging Judge Branca's kangaroo court or the Dodger greats remembering old times, it's always a treat to hear these guys.
We have the 40th anniversary of the 55 championship this year, and there'll be a real sentimental meeting in Brooklyn with a lot of wonderful people. So, yeah, I could have played in another era maybe wish for more money. You couldn't buy the 6 pennants in 12 years that I was fortunate enough to be a part of, nor play with a team. Can you imagine how it felt for me as a kid from Indiana to stand on the mound and look around at Hodges, Jackie Robinson, Reese, Billy Cox, later Gilliam was in the infield, pitching to Campy, Duke in the outfield with Ferrillo, and a few others in left field. But, you know, I used to stand on the mound, and honest to gosh, I would tell myself how lucky I was to be pitching with this team and how fortunate it was I didn't have to pitch against them because they're a great lineup. But the Dodger tradition is not easy to put into words, but it's lived out, and it's lived out here, and I think that's why we have campers that are 10, 12, 15 year returnees, because even Yankee fans that come here and leave and say, you know, there's something about that Dodger blue. And it really is.
When we got into Brooklyn, there was just something about it that was amazing to us. You know, we were really in awe of everything. And I was at the Cardinals 5 years, in their minor leagues mostly, part-time at the main club, in the Pittsburgh 4. But there was just not a feeling today to me about those clubs like it was with the Brooklyn Dodgers. There's just something about it when you speak baseball to me, you speak Brooklyn. Besides all the good players, and I like to feel it in their time, we kept this tradition going. Talked about the characters we had, you forgot the name, Billy Lowe's. Lord, he would have to take you a long ways. And what other team in the world had a pitcher that was a preacher on the mound? So I like to think it a little bit of part of it, and it was great, and I just don't know what else to say except I don't know where it started, but there is something. The fellas after my time have carried it on. Well, I can just name great players, and it's been great, and I thank you for having me around, fellas. Thank you.
All right. When I got to the ball club, there were guys who were on the club that were about ready to leave that had this tradition from 1941, talking about Hugh Casey and Pete Reiser, fellows like that, that were outstanding baseball players. They passed along this thing, along with Pee-wee, who I can't say enough for, because I think Pee-wee was the guy that did it. He was our captain, He was a man that take you aside, and I don't think there's a man in here that was a teammate of Pee-wee's that couldn't tell you something in their career that made them a better player because of Pee-wee Reese talking to them and suggesting things that they did.
You know, I know a lot of people, and I know all the ex-players in here will agree with me. Boy, I know a ton of my friends that would give anything in the world today to have a major league uniform on, or some of them even a minor league uniform on, to be an instructor, to be a major league coach. I mean, there's a lot of great baseball people out in our world that don't have a job in baseball that would, it's been their whole life too, but there's only so many jobs around. And I can again say one thing. 46 years in the game, I have never drawn a paycheck outside of baseball.
And it was just the fact that here we were, all young people. I don't think we realized just what was going on at that time. How eminently important it was for this country. What was going to happen? Everything was going to change. And this was changing it. The media, Jackie coming into the game with Roy, Dan Bankhead, Don Newcomb, Gilliam coming a little later. It was just something really great that was happening. It was being on a team that had 26 farm clubs. St. Louis had 27. There were only 16 teams in the league. To be a major league was really something because there just weren't many jobs open.
I think the most thrilling thing that ever happened to me when I first began playing pro ball was to put that Dodger uniform on the first time, and that is no lie. We've got a picture at home that was taken. I said, you got to take a picture of this in this Dodger uniform. Well, those experiences in those years here with Ronnie in the bullpen, I can still remember these guys taught me about baseball. Sitting there for all those years with them, every time the phone rang, it would be Miller and Peronoski. Both these guys get up. But during the game, they were funny, to be honest with you, they were funny. But you know they could be joking about something and never miss a trick on the field. I still don't know how you did that. You used to sit with your back to the wall, to the stands. The field was over here, and he knew everything that was going on out there. I never quite understood that.
And my claim to fame in baseball as a pitcher was in 1955, when we were leading the National League by 14 games in July. And I was figuring out the various ways that I was going to spend my World Series money in. When all of a sudden I was summoned into the office of Buzzy Bavese, who was then the general manager, and he said, son, he said, I've got bad news. I said, what's wrong, Buzzy? One of your relatives sick? He said, no, you're going to have to go back to Montreal, which was our AAA club at the time. I said, wait a minute, Buzzy, are you trying to tell me you've got to send me back to Montreal? Well, last year when you called me up, I was 14-5 when you called me to the big leagues. 2 years ago, I won 20 games at Montreal. And you're telling me that I've got to leave this ball club? He said, Tommy, I got one guy I have to cut off of this club. He said, it's a tough job. He said, if you were the general manager, who would you cut? And I, without any hesitation, I said, Koufax. So God's honest truth. God's honest truth. I said, here's a guy that can't hit a barn door 60 feet away with a baseball. And you're telling me that you're going to keep this guy and send me out? He said, well, the rules of baseball provide that if you receive over a $4,000 bonus, you have to remain on a major league club for 2 years. So he says, Koufax stays, and you must go. And now, I can walk around and honestly say, it took one of the greatest left-hand pitchers of all time to knock me off of that Brooklyn club.
All right, let's get into the award for the evening. The play of the day.
Every night, an award is given for the outstanding play of the day. Sometimes it's not easy choosing a winner. In this camp, we had a lot of good plays. Here's a few of them.
you're unbelievable. You're unbelievable. Singly lies, so mean he can ask us. Pushing down the reticence, bringing out your high self. Think of the fine times, pushing down the better view. Instead of bringing the answers to what the world and everything you ask to. Brace yourself, you crazy beast. I know this world and what it seems.
It's unbelievable.
You burden me with your questions. You have me tell no lies. You'll always ask why you talk about smart replies. You say to me, I don't talk enough. But when I do, I'm a fool. These times I've spent, I've realized you should prove and leave you. The things you say, your purpose just away. The things you say is what I love you more. The things you say, your platforms just give you away. The things you say, you're unbelievable.
Ladies and gentlemen, look at Kong, the eighth wonder of the world.
Yeah, Bundy here. I'm a little tied up right now, but here's some more friends of mine.
Hi, I'm Bob Miller from Agoura Hills, California. This is really a dream come true, and I really appreciate my wife letting me come out here for this week and leaving Brian and Trini alone. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bob Seelan from Tarzana, California. I first of all want to thank my lovely wife, Lisa. I missed you all week. This is a dream come true. I want to thank my kids, Rachel, Ryan, Jordan, and Joey. And this is like playing Little League after been coaching all these years. I love it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Steve Sherman from Agoura Hills, California. Thanks to DaMama Marsha and DaBaby Haley. It's been a great time here, and I look forward to coming back if you'll let me.
Hi, I'm Robert F. Gregory from Bronxville, New York. I'd like to say hi to my loved ones back there, Linda, Alex, and Steven. And I'd like to thank Sal LaRocca for bringing me down to a wonderful camp. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Neil Adams from Reseda, California. I'd like to thank my wife, Sue, for letting me come down here and spend time with the friends that I've made over the years. It's just a wonderful thing to do. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Don Tully from Norco, California. This is my first time in Florida. It's been a tremendous experience. I've enjoyed every minute of it. Susan, next to marrying you, this has been the greatest experience of my life. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Bill Goldberg. I'm from Pacific Palisades, California. I lived in Vero Beach for 4 years in the 1970s, and I haven't had a chance to revisit my old home because I'm having such a great time here. It's one of the best experiences of my life. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Steve McClure from Indianapolis, Indiana. I'm a rookie here at Vero Beach at the Dodgers training camp. I'd just like to say thank you to my lovely wife, Sylvia, and also to all the great Dodger greats here at Vero Beach, including Carl Erskine, a fellow Hoosier.
Good morning, folks. My name is Mike Sussman. I'm from Newport Beach, California, and I'm a Yankee fan. However, I'm here at the greatest Dodger camp of all. I want to thank my wife, Janet, my two kids, my dog and a cat for sending me to this greatest Grateful Dead concert I've ever been to. Thanks, Deadheads.
Hi, I'm Jim Desart from Rancho Palos Verdes, California. I want to thank my lovely wife, Jane, for allowing me to come here and my sons, Michael and Patrick, for taking all that time and working out with me. Thanks, guys.
Another Dodgetown tradition is Western Barbecue Night. It's also the night the campers get to show off a little bit. Ralph Branca organizes and MCs the show.
It's not the words I wish that I could stay. It's more the way you
look. It's very appropriate that one of the most remarkable and memorable performances in all the entertainment was last year's special rendition by Dr. Stolberg of Who Wrote the Book of Love. So would Harry Horowitz please come up? We're all going to sing that in fond remembrance of Doc Stolberg's wonderful rendition. And if anybody sings on key, you're going to be fined a dollar.
Is this working?
It's working.
Then it's not, then it won't
please
be good.
Please join in now. He's a good guy, he volunteered.
Oh, I wonder who
wrote.
You're all supposed to sing.
Love,
chapter one, we love you, we love you with all your heart.
Who wrote the book of love?
I'm going to do a medley of some older songs, some old songs you might know. When I was 17, we started to play in bars in Brooklyn. And we'd get there real early and set up the equipment real early when there was nobody there. But there was always, like, usually one guy there, one older guy. Of course, when you're 17, everybody's older. And there'd be, he'd be sitting there crying in his beer, and there'd be one of, either one of these old songs playing on a jukebox. Made me leave my happy home. You took my love, now you're gone. Since I fell for you, love brings such misery and pain. I guess I'll never be the same since I fell for you. Well, it's too bad and it's too sad, but I'm in love with you. First you love me, then you snub me, but what can I do? I'm still in love with you. No, I'll never see the light. I get the blues most every night since I fell for you. I don't have hopes and dreams, I don't have plans and schemes, I don't have anything since I don't have you. I don't have hearts and flowers, I don't have happy hours, I don't have anything since I don't have you.
Thank you.
Just a little bit busy right now, but my friends sure aren't.
How you doing? Mike Tartaglia. This is my second year at Dodger Camp. Having a great time. Glad to be here. It's really good being a veteran instead of a rookie. Hi, Gina.
Hi, I'm Harry Horowitz from Encino, California. This is my second Dodger Camp, and it's very exciting to be here. I want to thank my wife, Sherry, and my children, Justin and Amanda, for allowing me to go ahead and take off to enjoy this camp and to play with the Great Falls team, and we're winning the championship this year. Thank you.
I'm Sal LaRocca from Franklin Lakes, New Jersey. This is my 10th camp, and thanks to my wife for putting up with me. I look forward to coming back again. Thank you.
My name's Emmett Carney. They call me Em. I'm from Indianapolis, Indiana. I live in Speedway, home of the Indianapolis 500. I want to thank Marv Bittinger and my wife for permitting me to come down here for my second camp. Thanks.
My name is Herb Lewis. I'm from Pacific Palisades, California. This is my sixth camp. I'm 79 and a half, going on 80, and I can say this. My wife has me signed up for the next 10 years. And I'm not down here just to see friends. I'm out here to play ball, and I'm doing that. It's been the greatest camp these past 6 years. This camp especially has been a terrific camp for me. The many friends that I've met through the years are back here. And I've made a lot of new friends. All I can say is that those folks out there who haven't had an opportunity of knowing what Dodger Town is should give themselves an opportunity of coming down here. This is without a doubt one of the greatest weeks of my life, and I'm looking forward to coming back many, many times. Thank you.
Bob Latto, Los Angeles, California. Having a wonderful time here. I owe this great time to my wife Donna, to our kids, Laura, Tracy, or what's the other one? Lauren. Thanks very much for letting me go back here. I love you guys.
Francis, I'm here again at the old fantasy camp. Thank you for sending me. Francis, stay with me. Don't leave me. I've said a lot of nasty things about you, but please, please don't leave me, Fern. Bye-bye.
My name is Barry Gastman.
I'm from Rancho Palos Verdes, California. I'd like to thank my wife for encouraging me to come. I viewed this as an opportunity to get in shape for ski season, to lose some weight. It's been much more than that. It's been an absolutely fantastic experience, and I look forward to coming back in the future.
Hi, I'm Steve Silverstein from Santa Ana, California. I'd like to send... Hi, I'm Steve Silverstein from Santa Ana, California. Having a great time this week, and I'm happy that this week that... I'd like to thank Nordstrom's for not having the half yearly sale this week, so my wife would be home and I know where she is. I'd like to say hi to my boys, Oren and Matthew, and my daughters, Tova and Shayna. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Bob Conklin from Old Town. I'd like to thank my wife, Deborah, my daughter, Elisa, and my son, Robert, for sending me here for my 50th birthday. I'm having the time of my life. Thanks, everybody.
Almost before you know it, it's time for the big game between the campers and the instructors. November 1994 saw the first ever night game played at Dodger Town Camp, and it turned out to be a pretty good game.
Beginning with the San Antonio game, managed by Clem Devine, with Reggie Smith and Leo Posada as coaches. First, wearing number 39 from Merced, California, Neil Adams. Wearing number 28 from Rancho Palos Verdes, California, Jim Desart. Welcome, Ron Baranowski. Hello, guys. winning percentage. Led the National League in strikeouts in 1945. Play hello to Elwood, Preacher Rowe. Dodger history, appeared in more games than any other Los Angeles Dodger, 2,181, in his 18-year major league career, and his games in Dodger uniform are second only to Zach Wheaton. Played in 3 All-Star games, 4 World Series. He is back as a coach for the Dodgers after a 2-year stint as manager of Albuquerque. He was a coach for the Dodgers from 87-91.
Good defense gets Alan Forrest leading off the game for the Campers. And although Phil Simon and Neil Adams get hits off Carl Erskine, the Campers are shut out.
He's out by half a step. Ground ball looks fair, down over third base in the corner. And Simon, despite having, well, his runner will run for him. Phil goes back. So Simon gets a double. Two out. Short little pop-up, drops in behind Zimmer. Let's see, are they going to trust Reggie's? They do trust his arm. Matter of fact, they fear it. A little humid.
San Antonio's Barry Siegel starts off well by getting Billy Russell, but hits by Don Zimmer, Rick Mundy, and Reggie Smith quickly make the score 2-0.
3-2, here comes the pitch from Siegel. Zimmer goes to the other way, and it drops in. Base hit. Monday hits a sharply into the right field. There goes Zimmer. And he stops. Here's Siegel to the pitch.
Uh-oh.
Reggie hits it deep.
I see that pop-up drill.
And it's over the center fielder's head. Here comes Zimmer. Followed by Monday. Is there going to be a play at the plate? There's going to be a play, but it's not going to get him. Monday has touches home.
Jennifer Kessler gets on base in the second, but that's all the Campers can manage to do.
Erskine
fumbled it. That's a base hit, Doc.
The instructors have little trouble getting two more runs in the second, as Jeff Torberg, John Debus, and Leo Posada all get hits off Camper Barry Scripps, and the score jumps to 4-0.
That's why he was the pitcher, as far as the camp is concerned. There's a shot to deep left center. It's not going to get out, but it does drop.
Debus really going to get at least a double out of it.
And
oh.
He hits a shot into left center. Looks like it's going to drop. And let's see. Torborg's coming in, who's tagging. Right behind him is Debus. And there goes the bell. And two more for the Dodger veterans. And at the end of two innings here at Holman Stadium, the Dodger veterans 4, the Campers 0.
The Campers managed to break through with their first run in the third inning off Dave Wallace. Marv Bittinger starts it off with a single, and a hot grounder by Denny Wells gets the run home. It's 4-1.
Zimmer, Don makes it exciting, throws it one hot, Debus scoops it, he's out. There's a close play at the plate, and Canastra scores.
All right, wait.
Oh, my goodness.
Finally put it on the board.
In the third, the instructors load the bases on John Shoemaker's single and a couple of walks. But San Antonio's Mike Lerner shuts out the Dodger greats when he gets Reggie Smith to ground out. It's still 4-1.
Out. And especially this man coming up. And look how anxious he is, Reggie Smith.
Oh, wow.
And bottom of the third. Reggie, again, anxiously, grounds to third, forces the second to Bagley.
How about that?
And the veterans do not score. The plate, of course, that's Bruce.
With Mike Lerner still on the mound in the fourth, the instructors put together 5 hits and 4 runs, and now lead by 8-1.
And was originally drafted by the Oakland A's, but decided not to go. He signed with the Dodgers instead. Debus, a little pop to the right side. That's going to be exciting. Bittinger turns and circles, and it drops.
Looks like the lights might have got him.
Shoemaker. Hit to the right side. It's going to go through. Let's see if Torberg scores. Debus goes to third.
He's chugging. He's moving. He's doing it.
Yep, Torberg's in.
See ya.
Into the setting.
Speaking of which,
it looks like he's
speaking of which,
that.
He does get one all out over second, but Debus.
Gonna hold.
And look at this. Debus holds.
Unless you want to force down here, boys.
Shoemaker, Rick is back, and Debus is sort of
resting.
I think Debus' base running is a tribute to his clean living.
Oh,
there's
oh,
a shot by Llewellyn up the middle. Debus has no
very
choice now.
Memory for Mike Lerner.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Look at this.
Uh-oh. That's 2 and 3.
Yes, besides...
They're not going to stop.
Dave Wallace again shuts out the Campers in the fifth, although Bob Councilman smacks a sharp single.
Center field, line drive.
In the instructor fifth, Greg Sorg gives up 3 hits and 3 runs. But right in the middle of it, he gets a neat memory by striking out Jeff Torborg. It's now 11-1.
Over into right. It's picked up. But nothing's going to stop Russell from coming on home. Sorg is dying for a strikeout. We can see it on his face even from here. And he gets his wish. Starbird gets to go back to the dugout the hard way. And he will get a piece of that right off the bat. Monday is going to jog on back. 10-1. And with Smith makes it an even 11.
Both the campers and instructors are shut out in the sixth. But in the seventh, the campers score twice on a walk to Bart Kaufman and hits by Jim Leahy and Sandy Krigler. And it's now 11-3.
Uh-oh, there's going to be a discussion here.
And now Lasorda's going over to first. He's going to have a little chat with Kaufman. Kind of makes you wish there was a microphone on those guys. Oh, that goes right past Lasorda.
Shot up the middle.
Deep into center. Bundy don't need to move very fast on that one.
No, he doesn't.
Besides, it'll be ball one. Krigler
up the middle.
Rolls that over. Into center.
Monday. No, it's by Monday. The wet ball. Here comes.
He's coming. A whooping and a whooping.
Here comes Bundy.
He's, oh, you can feel the earth shaking now.
Yeah.
And that's two for the campers.
How about that?
Two in a row. This is no longer a one-run ball game.
Well.
With great fall Sandy Krigler on the mound, the instructors come right back with two runs of their own and make the score 13-3.
And has a collision with Bundy at first.
Oh.
Zimmer, the grounder to short. Harry Horowitz takes his time. Long throw.
Overthrows it to Bundy.
He overthrows it.
We're supposed to have earthquakes here in Florida.
Bundy, a shot. I told you he was going to go to Bundy.
And Bundy.
Bundy makes the play. Hey.
And you're out of there, pal.
I told you, I called that one. That's Reggie Smith.
You know, we've been meaning to ask.
In the camper eight off Tommy Lasorda, the campers go quietly with the only hit, a single by Sal Palachetti.
The eighth.
Good defense and good pitching by Sandy Krigler gives the campers a rare thing at camp as the Dodger greats go 1-2-3 and out in the eighth.
Bundy makes a nice scoop. Bottom of the eighth, 13-3.
Drilled.
Harry Horowitz.
Picks it up over
short. Gobbles it up, makes his throw.
Bundy.
And this time he gets it to Bundy. Bottom of the eighth here at Holman Stadium.
Oh, that goes past Krigler over to second.
Shoemaker with a shot to Horowitz. Again over to Bundy. And I told you.
Three in, three out.
They named the town after Tarzan.
Lasorda gives up a hit by Bill Smith in the camper ninth, but good defense keeps the score at 13-3.
And he'll get a single out of it. Whoa, that go. Oh, my goodness gracious.
Line drive. Lasorda tried to be fancy. Should get fined for that. Hot dogging.
And he's out of there
but
anyway.
He gets an assist.
The instructors run the score up to 15-3 in their half of the ninth off camper Don Tully. But that's what happens when you face hitters like Billy Russell, Rick Mundy, Reggie Smith, and Jeff Torber.
I keep all my money there.
Oh, Mundy has shot up the middle.
Smacks it into the center field. He'll go to first. Russell will come home. Didn't have to work too hard at that.
Oh, Reggie with a shot to center.
Dropped into center.
Going to drop.
Mundy. And he gets a hit, driven in to right. Is going to be picked up? No.
It's going
to
drop. Here comes Mundy to end the inning.
With the second run. And it'll be a 15-3 ball game as we go into the top of 10.
Steve.
In the 10th, the camper set a new scoring record by getting four runs off Lasorda. This is the way it went. A walk to Barry Gassman, a double by Steve Silverstein, John Boulware hit by a pitch, Don Tully on with an error, Bob Seelan, an RBI fielder's choice, and Walt Benson produces a run-scoring error. Chris Woodward ends the camper's comeback by flying out. By now, the score is a very respectable 15-7.
So now it's only an 11-run deficit.
15-4.
No outs.
Oh, in the dirt.
Oh, another more body contact.
Hit him. That hit him. Okay,
I think he definitely got it.
Hit him on a bouncer straight. Yeah. 9-4.
He gets a hit on that. Oh!
Fair ball.
Shoemaker
with a
great gets
play.
A hold of it. Debo doesn't pick it up, though.
Doesn't do it.
So it would have been a spectacular play, is all for naught. Drilled over to
Dave Wallace.
Picked off.
After camper Bill Smith gives up a double to John Debus, Denny Llewellyn ends the big game with a two-run homer. But the final score is not bad. Instructors 17, campers 7.
It's out of here.
Did it again.
It's Llewellyn hits a home run.
The big game is history, and now it's time to reward those campers who excelled on the field during the week with some very nice trophies. The awards banquet is coming up next.
I'm extremely pleased that this personable camper has been awarded membership in our Los Angeles Dodger Adult Baseball Camp Hall of Fame, Sal LaRocca. Sonny Carter Award is for really Mr. Congeniality, a fellow you'd like to be around and meet. And this vote is from the staff members. And the winner is Bill Smith from the Albuquerque Club.
And this guy, we played against him a couple of days ago. Every time that I ever saw him, he was diving for a ball. He was always running. He ran hard on the bases. He's with the Albuquerque Club, and unfortunately, he played a little bit too good against us. Mr. Hustle for this camp at Dodgers.